हे गाइस, दिस इज मी राज किशोर रंजन। दिस इज माय फर्स्ट लेक्चर ओवर इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ डायनेमिक प्रोग्रामिंग। दिस इज अबाउट मी। आई एम बीटेक कंप्यूटर साइंस एंड इंजीनियरिंग ग्रेजुएट फ्रॉम आईआईटी पटना। फॉर एनी रेट एंड रिव्यू एंड रिकमेंडेशन यू आर मोस्ट वेलकम। यू कैन फॉलो मी ऑन unacademy.com/user/राजकिशोर रंजन। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट टुडे लेक्चर। इन टुडे लेक्चर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट डायनेमिक प्रोग्रामिंग, इट्स इंपॉर्टेंस एंड यूजेज इन मैनी प्रॉब्लम्स। देर आर मैनी प्रॉब्लम्स लाइक फिबोनाकी नंबर्स, रट कटिंग प्रॉब्लम्स, मैट्रिक्स चेन मल्टीप्लीकेशन प्रॉब्लम्स, वेयर वी कैन यूज द कंसेप्ट ऑफ डायनेमिक प्रोग्रामिंग टू सॉल्व दिस प्रॉब्लम्स। सो लेट्स डिस्कस अबाउट फिबोनाकी नंबर्स। फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल वी हैव टू डिस्कस अबाउट फिबोनाकी नंबर, एंड ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ फाइंडिंग द एनथ नंबर ऑफ फिबोनाकी नंबर वी विल सी द कंसेप्ट ऑफ डायनेमिक प्रोग्रामिंग। ओके, नाउ अ फिबोनाकी नंबर इज अ सीक्वेंस ऑफ नंबर इन विच इच नंबर इज द सम ऑफ द टू प्रिसीडिंग नंबर्स। इफ यू सी दिस सीक्वेंस एंड इफ यू सेड दैट द जीरोथ नंबर इज जीरो एंड द फर्स्ट नंबर इज वन, देन द नेक्स्ट नंबर विल बी वन एंड द अगेन नेक्स्ट नंबर इज टू, देन थ्री, फोर, एट, थर्टीन, एक्सेट्रा। ओके, सो द प्रॉब्लम स्टेटमेंट हेयर इज वी हैव टू राइट अ कोड टू फाइंड द इनथ फिबोनाकी नंबर। द इनपुट फॉर्म, लेट्स सी द इनपुट फॉर्मेट ऑफ दिस कोड। The input format of this code is the first line contain integer t denoting the number of test cases, and for each test case it will take an integer n, and on the basis of integer n we have to print the nth Fibonacci number for each test case. This is the output format. If we see this Fibonacci number of the sequence, this is nothing but the sequence of Fibonacci number, then the sequence goes on 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, 34 and 55. Now if you see the nth term of the sequence, then except the first and second term, that means 0th and first number of Fibonacci number, we see that every term is the sum of, except 0th and first number, every term is the sum of its first two preceding term. That means if we see the nth term, then it would be equal to n minus 1 term plus n minus 2 term for all n greater than equal to 2. If we try to write the pseudocode for finding the nth Fibonacci number, this is the pseudocode for the finding the nth Fibonacci number, then we have created a function int fibn, where the first four line of this function, this is nothing but the base cases for this function. For n is equal to 0, it will return simply value 0. For n is equal to 1, it will return simply value 1. And for n greater than equal to 2, it will return fib n minus 1 plus fib n minus 2. So this is the pseudocode. Okay, let's try to implement this pseudocode in a programming language. I have implemented this pseudocode in a programming language, CPP. Here we can see there are two functions, main function and fib int n function. Okay, in main function we are simply take an input t, which is nothing but the number of test cases, and for each test case we have taken an input n, and on the basis of n we have to print the nth Fibonacci number. Here in the last line of main function we have called fib n function. What fib n function is doing here, if we see this code, then the first four line is simply the base cases we have already discussed in the pseudocode, and the last line will return fib n minus 1 plus fib n minus 2, which is nothing but our nth Fibonacci number. Okay, this is nothing but a recursive function. If we try to implement this function, then we can get output like this. We have taken three test cases, and for each test case we have taken the value of n is equal to 14 and 15 here, and it will print 9th Fibonacci number is 34, 14th Fibonacci number is 377, and 15th Fibonacci number is 610. Let's try to draw the recursion tree of the function fib int n. Whatever the function we have created here, let's try to draw the recursion tree of this function. For n is equal to 5, let's try to draw the recursion tree of fib 5. Since n greater than equal to 0 and 1 here, so fib 5 will break into two parts, fib 4 and fib 3. Similarly, if we call the function fib 4, then fib 4 will break into two parts, fib 3 and fib 2. Similarly, fib 3 will break into two parts, fib 2 and fib 1. And similarly, this fib 2 also will break into two parts, fib 1 and fib 3. This fib 3 also will break into two parts, fib 2 and fib 1. for n is equal to 6, if we try to draw the recursion tree of fib 6, then it will first of all fib 6 will be broken or will break into two parts, fib 5 and fib 4. Again, in the same fashion, fib 5 will break into two parts and its sub problems also. Here, what we are showing here, first of all, if we try to see function this fib 6, fib 6 will be broken into two parts, fib 5 and fib 4. These are nothing but the sub problems of our main problems, fib 6. And we can see here in this case, for n is equal to 6, we can see here fib 4 will be called by fib 6 here. Also, fib 4 will be called by fib 5 here. That means fib 4 is the right child of fib 6 as well as fib 4 is the left child of fib 5 also. So, these are the sub problems, but these sub problems are overlapped to each other. So, in this case, we can see here, or we called it as a overlapping sub problems. And what is happening here, these overlapping sub problems has been called multiple times. If you see in this code, fib 4 is called 2 times. Similarly, we can see here about fib 3. Fib 3 is also called multiple times, first time here, then again here. And there is also the same thing happening with fib 2 also. So what we are doing here, in case of overlapping sub problems, we are doing many unnecessary computation of the same function multiple times. Okay, we can see the same things fib 5 we also have. Here fib 3 is the right child of fib 5 as well as fib 3 is the left child of fib 4. So fib 3 is also called here multiple times, here 2 times. Again fib 2 is also called 3 times, first time here, then here. So these are nothing but the overlapping sub problems, and in overlapping sub problems we are doing many unnecessary multiple computation. Now if we try to find the time complexity of the implemented function, this function, if we try to find the time complexity of this function, that means for the time complexity of the whole code, then it will be like, since here some function is being called many times, so the recurrence relation for time complexity is like this. Here tn is equal to tn minus 1 plus tn minus 2 plus big O of 1. Similarly, if we solve this recurrence relation, then tn will be big O of 2 to the power n. This is nothing but a exponential time complexity, which is very, very huge. In exponential time complexity, we know that for the large value of n, it will take many times for print the output. That means for this code, if we take n is equal to 50, that means n is equal to 50 we take as an input, then it will take almost 30 seconds to print the output. And for n greater than equal to 50, it will take more time. So in exponential, or and why is this happening? This is happening because of this overlapping sub problems many times. Whatever we are doing here, unnecessary computation, this things is happening for this reason. So here the problem statement is, how can we avoid these multiple overlapping sub problems? The solution in this case, if we could have stored the value of sub problems like fib 4 fib 3 fib 2 etc, then instead of computing it again and again, we could have wrote the old stored value. Whenever it will be called second time, we have already stored the value of all the sub problems when it will be computed the first time, and when it will be called the second time, we can simply use those stored value. There is no need to call those function again and again. If we try to see this function, then there are also two function, main and fib int n function. Okay, here what we are doing here, first we have created a global array fib num, and in main function we have initiated fib num all the value of index of fib num would be minus 1, and try to store all the sub problem, the value of sub problems in this array. Okay, let's see this code. In this code, if you see here, whenever we call fib int n, then it will first of all check in the array, is that function, the value of that function has been stored in the array or not. If it is not stored, that means then it will simply goes to in the loop of if. Here it will, the for 4 line is the base case for finding the value of nth Fibonacci number. For n is equal to 0, it will store fib num n is equal to 0, and for n is equal to 1, it will store the value 1. And for further value of n, that means n greater than equal to 2, it will store the value of fib n minus 1 plus fib n minus 2. Okay. And finally, we can return the value of fib num n. So this is the calculated value. If it is already stored in the array, then it will be returned by here. There is no need to call this. Let's look over this code. One more thing I want to tell you about this code is that what we are doing here, we simply here storing the result of the memory whenever we solve the problem first time, and next time we simply do a lookup. So this approach is nothing but called a top down approach, or somewhere it is also called a memoization approach also. Let's look this code. In this code, we have created two functions, main function and fibint function. In fibint function, whenever it will be called, we have created a array fib num n plus 1, where we are storing the value of all value of nth Fibonacci number, that means the sequence. In this for loop, we can say here, we will start from the value I is equal to 0, that means from the bottom, and try to compute the nth Fibonacci numbers. For I less than equal to 1, we simply store the value of fib num I is equal to I, and for I greater than equal to 2, fib num I would be equal to fib num I minus 1 plus fib num I minus 2, and finally we returning the value of fib num n. So here we are not in both, in both test case we are not computed the multiple function, we are not doing many unnecessary computation. In this case, we first of all pre-compute the solution in a linear fashion and try to store those value in a table in this array. This is nothing but called a table or array, doesn't matter. And if we try to see the time complexity of both the code, then all the code had been for value of n, it will be called, it will be run only for n times, so the time complexity would be big of n. Here if we see here, the time complexity is big of n, because this for loop is only run for n times, so the time complexity is also here polynomial time complexity as compared to that time we have get in this code we have got exponential time complexity, which is very, very huge. Okay, so whatever the concept we have used in both the function, that means for the top down approach or bottom up approach for implementing this function, these both concept are called nothing but the concept of dynamic programming algorithm. So let's have a discussion about dynamic programming. What is dynamic programming? First of all, dynamic programming solve problems by combining the solution of sub problems. Okay, a dynamic programming algorithm solves each sub problem just once and then saves each sub problems or store the value of those sub problems. We typically apply dynamic programming to optimization problems. Optimization problems are those problems where we find the best solution from all feasible solutions. Here one more thing we have to remember, whenever we apply in dynamic programming algorithm, we follow a sequence of four steps. We first of all, we have to characterize the structure of optimal solution. This is the first step. Then recursively define the value of optimal solution. Here we can understand the second step here, where we have recursively defined Fibonacci number n is equal to Fibonacci number n minus 1 plus Fibonacci number n minus 2. So in this way we can recursively define the value of an optimal solution. Then compute the value of optimal solution. Either you are using top down approach or bottom up approach. That means either using the approach of this code or the approach of this code. It doesn't matter. Now on the basis of top down or bottom up approach, construct an optimal solution from computed information. Okay. So this is the all over about dynamic programming, where we are discussing the basic thing about dynamic programming. In the next lecture, we are discussing more concept about dynamic programming. So thanks for watching. Have a good day.